Lehigh University, and welcome to Laser Safety Training. I'm Brian Slocum, Director of the Design Labs, and today we're going to cover all of the things you need to know to be safe with the laser. One of the most powerful tools in all of the design labs, the laser cutter can be used for an almost infinite number of things. But, like they say in the movies, with great power comes great responsibility. And so it's your job as a student here using the laser cutter to make sure you're doing it safely. Before we jump in on safety, let's first start by taking a look at our laser system. The components inside our laser include the drive system that moves all of the parts, the laser tube that actually generates the laser beam used for cutting, the lens carriage that moves the laser beam around the surface of your material, an exhaust port that helps to suck away smoke and vapor from the material, an air assist system that positively pressurizes the space around the laser so that we don't get any fogging of the lens, the bed of the laser that supports our material, a control panel that we use at the laser to choose our file and start the laser cutting process, and lastly, a safety interlock switch that prevents us from doing anything silly, like sticking our hands inside the laser while it's running. Let's zoom in on the lens carriage, shall we? Looking at this diagram, we can see several components. At the top left, we have the beam that comes from the laser tube. It fires against a mirror, gets culminated through a lens, and ultimately cuts through our material. A couple things to note here. You will see in this diagram that material is removed. It's actually vaporized, meaning instead of cutting where we have like sawdust, we break the material down to tiny, tiny particles and oftentimes down to the chemicals that make up the material. We call that gap the kerf. And while it's incredibly small and often negligible for most applications, there is material removed. Generally, it's like 0.2 to 0.3 millimeters. Think of a mechanical pencil with a very, very fine lead. It's smaller than that. Okay, so now that we know how the laser works, we have to talk about the scary safety things. That's right, all of the things that could potentially go wrong or that we can do incorrectly that can cause somebody to get hurt or the laser cutter to catch on fire or all of the above. There are two primary dangers we have to address when laser cutting, and we're going to talk about these one at a time. The first danger is fire. That's right. And ladies and gentlemen, this is not a hypothetical situation. In the 20 years I've been here running laser cutters at Lehigh, we've had 3 fires that have caused several thousand dollars worth of damage. So let's talk about what the things are that contribute to fire in the laser cutter. There's 4 things that we have to be aware of and work to mitigate in order to prevent fires. The first one is using a non-laser safe material in the laser cutter. It's really easy to put something in there that is very flammable and will cause it to catch on fire and it will go out of control very, very quickly. So first and foremost, as a laser user, you have to make sure the material you are cutting is laser safe. Not only that, you need to make sure it is from a trusted vendor. We've had a couple issues in the last couple years. People have purchased things through places like Amazon, and maybe they were mislabeled or they were sent the wrong thing. And so they get materials that are potentially very dangerous to put on the laser cutter. So a trusted source. We like MakerStock. We like Inventables. We like McMaster Carr. Those are places where you can get materials that we trust the vendor, as long as you know that it's laser safe. So, how do you know if something's laser safe? Well, it's a great question, and I think I have a good answer for you. Let's go to the Design Labs website, and we can find out where the list of laser safe materials are.
So you're going to start by navigating to designlabs.lehigh.edu, going to the Design Labs Wilbur site, going into Makerspace, scrolling down till you find the laser cutter, and then if you scroll down through all of the laser cutter information, at the very bottom of the page, you will find a little button that says Materials List. That will take you to another page, and you will see it's divided by laser cutter approved materials and laser banned materials. We are actually using a friend's page for the moment on this. This may change. We're adopting our own version. But you will see that the website lists what is banned and why it's banned. The one thing I do want to call out, this list does say that foam core is not an approved material. We cut an awful lot of foam core here at Lehigh. So that is fine to cut. But the other materials on the list cannot be cut. Okay, the second thing that contributes to fire in the laser cutter is the mismatch of material settings with the material being cut. So, as a user, you need to make sure that both the material and the material thickness match the actual material that you're cutting. This is important. If you are cutting 1/8 inch acrylic and you set it for 1/4 inch acrylic, the laser is going to move slower than it needs to. There will be residual heat, and that will potentially cause a fire. So, making sure that you match both the material and the material thickness is really important. That is done in the Ruby software, and we will cover that in the second video. But as a preview, we're kind of showing you where that is here in this video. Moving right along to our third danger that causes fire is the failure to focus properly. Do you all remember this graphic where we showed you the laser head and we called out the focal distance? As you can see in this image, that laser beam focuses to a single point where you have very high energy density. Above and below that point, that energy density is spread over a larger surface area. That means it's not cutting efficiently, but it's generating a lot of heat. This can sometimes be beneficial in the laser cutter. We push materials out of focus when we etch to get a burn or a char on the surface, which gives us a darker etch in most cases. But if we try to specifically cut through a material with the laser cutter out of focus, we end up causing excessive heat, and that turns into fire. That's right, we want to keep that material from burning. We need to keep the material focused. This part is done at the laser cutter itself. Every time you swap materials, the first time you use the laser, you need to make sure you focus on the material. Pushing the laser out of focus happens actually in the software. It doesn't happen at the laser. So always focus the laser on your material. We'll cover that in the third video when we're at the laser cutter. This brings us to our fourth issue that contributes to fire: overlapping or almost overlapping lines. This happens when you have a line that exists on top of itself. The laser cutter sees that as two distinct lines and it tries to cut it a second time. The first time it cuts through the material. The second time, however, there's no material to absorb the laser energy, and what results is heat. And we know that heat causes fire. So let's look at an example here in AutoCAD. I've drawn a simple box. We're going to use the mirror command, and we're going to use the bottom edge of that box as our mirror line. When I complete this command, that line through the center is actually two lines, and the laser cutter will cut them both. I can further complicate this by then copying that using a base point on the left edge and copying it to a base point on the right. Now both the center line is doubled up in both sides, and that vertical line is doubled up. If I go click on it, I hit erase or delete, nothing happens. It's because there's a second line. I have to go through that process twice in order for that to happen. and those double lines can potentially cause fire. Another issue that we can have when we do this is very close lines, lines that are close together. And so we have algorithms to solve the double line side. We don't have an algorithm that can get rid of lines that are very close to one another. So here I'm turning off OSNAP. I've zoomed in. I've copied this box. I'm positioning the second box very close to the first, right? They look like they're almost on top of each other. If I zoom in even more, you can see that gap. If I zoom out, these appear to be connected or one common line. The problem is the laser cutter will see that as two lines, and the algorithm will not delete the second line. It will cut both, and that will potentially cause a fire. So that wraps up the potential issue with fire. Let's move on to the second major issue, toxic fumes. Toxic fumes may be more dangerous than fire, and we need to be able to mitigate that, just like we did with fire. So there's three things that we really want to focus on here. The first one is one that should look familiar. We want to only use a laser safe material. Same thing, you have that website where you can go and look at laser safe materials. Most of the reason that materials are not laser safe is because they release toxic fumes. So let's play a little game here, shall we?
Name that toxic material!
I'm about to show you three different materials, and you have to tell me which one is the toxic material. Option number one, this lovely clear sheet of plastic. Option number two, this lovely clear sheet of plastic. And option number three, this lovely clear sheet of plastic. Could you spot the toxic plastic when laser cut? One of those materials will cut and etch beautifully with lovely polished edges. That would be acrylic. One of those materials will char and burn. That would be polycarbonate. And the third material will release toxic chloride gas that will kill everybody in the room and everybody outside. Chloride gas, by the way, is also known as mustard gas in the world of chemical warfare agents. Which one is which? Well, the true answer here is if you don't know what the material is, don't cut it, because that is what is on the line. One of those materials will look beautiful, and the other one is potentially deadly, and it's impossible to tell the difference between the three. So if you don't know what the material is, don't cut it. So that's the laser safe material. Second important step for preventing injury or damage from fumes, make sure the fume extraction is on. This is your job as a laser user. At mountaintop, you have to start the fume extractor at least a minute and a half before you start your cut. In Wilbur, you have to make sure that that fume extractor is on before you start your cut. It only takes a few extra seconds. In Wilbur, it's a little bit longer at mountaintop. If you don't hear the air running, don't make your cut. Stop the laser cutter. This is important for a couple reasons. One, the fumes will build up and go into the lab when you open the lid. Two, the smoke will cloud the lens, which will be hugely problematic. The lenses are very expensive. We have to make sure we're extracting the smoke and the fumes from inside the laser chamber. And last but not least, in our ways to prevent injury or damage from fumes, please wait about 10 to 15 seconds after the cut is done for the smoke and the fumes to get pulled out of the laser chamber. I know you're gonna be so excited to reach in there and grab your parts. An extra 10 or 15 seconds will not kill you. So that concludes the first video of the three video series for the laser training. Please tune in for video 2 and video 3 so that you can complete the quiz and then get your credentials for laser cutting. Happy laser cutting, everybody!